park, particularly you a state park, you can hunt, you can fish, you can just take everything from the park without people challenging you. But in India, you cannot even get off your jeep. You certainly cannot even pick a blade of grass. You certainly cannot go and kill an animal. That's for sure. So that's a very good policy. However, the Indian park system is given a very low priority, in spite of the fact that Project Tigers is a high-profile campaign. And one of the indications is that all the people who go and run those national parks are government employee misfits. It's considered to be a punishment post. If you have served in other departments and you did a bad job, you go into the National Park Service. And so all these people working for these national parks are either incompetent or corrupt or both. And I found very little exception to that. Well, there were some, but very little. And even India's wildlife conservation groups are not particularly trustworthy. When we got a 3-year grant of $100,000 each year, we obligated by the Canadian International Development Agency, we were given the obligation to give 60% of that money to a chosen Indian NGO. So we chose a certain group whose name I'm not going to mention, based upon its international reputation, based upon its founder, who is a very good guy. His son, however, is a different animal altogether. But we chose that organization based upon the reputation of the father. And so we gave $60,000 per year to this organization for 3 years straight. And I began to be suspicious after the end of the first year. I actually began to do some investigation of this organization the third year, in the second year. In the third year, I finally got proof positive that of the $60,000 that we gave to that organization, the CEO of that organization pocketed $50,000 a year. So we provided to his personal account $150,000 of tiger saving money. That's the system that we're working with. I then reported to the Canadian International Development Agency that, you know, that the $100,000 that you gave us as a grant for a year, $50,000 went into this guy's pocket. And guess what the Canadian International Development Agency said back to me? Cool it, Anthony, this is just the way it is. So in terms of foreign aid, the aiding agencies all take for granted that some of the money is going to be swallowed up by private interest anyway. So that is the non-governmental part of the wildlife enforcement scene. The government are very weak. The central government has almost no reach at all into the countryside. It's all the state government. The state government are generally economically motivated, and Project Tiger is a federal central government project. So the state government and the central government usually duke it out as to what is more important. The state government says, okay, this piece of land, we have done the prospecting, we sold such and such a mineral deposit there, mineral wealth. If it sits in a tiger reserve, then the central government and the state government would have to fight it out as to whether we're going to leave that place untouched or whether they could go in there and start mining or logging for that matter. So it is a very complex situation, and usually the central government loses out because it is, you know, just as the Chinese have been saying, the emperor is 3,000 miles away and his influence is non-existent very well. So, and Project Tiger originally was very strong. In the first 10 years, Project Tiger raised the population back up from 1,800, doubled it to about 3,500 by the end of the 1970s. However, came the 1990s, where, okay, the second part of Project Tiger was the banjo hunting altogether completely flat. And that, between these two, India's tiger population raised back up to about 4,000 by about the 1990s. But come the 1990s, poaching got really big because the Asian countries became economically affluent, and tiger bone began a big item in China, including the Chinatowns in North America, which I personally happen to have successfully crushed, both in Canada and in the US. But in India, India, the defense of the tigers where they live is very, very, very weak. Let me just give you a heartbreaking example as to why I say this. In 1998, I went to work in the Bandar Gar National Park, and Bandar Gar is not a very big place. It's about 400 square miles. Usually the formula is one tiger per square mile. So we estimated that the maximum tiger concentration is about 40 tigers, and that was in 1998. In 1999, when I went back there, I was faced with a very grim and very somber staff. I mean, I was quite well known at Bandar Gar because we made a film there, and it became a TV documentary series that was shown in 20 countries, including India. So I was a star in Bandar Gar. And these people, as soon as I went there, they just crowded around me and began to cry, etc. It was a very bad news for you. Of the 40 tigers in Bandar Gar, we have lost about 10 over that 12-month period. They got, and I was there to see one or two cases they found in some villages that there were rolls of tiger skin that are still, you know, the underside was still kind of moist, and some tiger bones with even ants crawling on it. And they matched the strike pattern of the skins and determined which tigers got killed. And that was one of the saddest thing was this tiger is called Sita that I've known for 2 years, and she had just a recent litter of cubs her last. And Sita's skin was never found, but one of her cubs' skin was found. Sita just disappeared with the other cub, and probably her skin is already on the way to China or on the way to Europe. Her bones to China, the skin to Europe usually, or Russia. And so that's a devastating loss, you know, 25% loss, and the 40 was already a very small number. I mean, if you want to sustain a population of big predators, you need about 250 breeding animals in one place. That includes tigers, grizzly bears, whatever. And 40 is just an inbreeding situation. But even thinking about that is a luxury, because first of all, if they're being killed in such large numbers, you know, talking about genetic integrity is a luxury that we really couldn't afford. We didn't have money for it. India doesn't have money for it. The world doesn't give a shit about it. I mean, this is a huge, huge problem with a magnificent species at stake, and the world just looks on or stays in oblivion, and if they were aware of it, they can help out. And it just leaves people like me to just go and just lock it up. And the trade is horrible too. I've gone undercover in both New Delhi and Calcutta to go into an enclave, those enclaves where the poachers and the traders usually go. And my mission was to go and uncover endangered species that's been poached, including tigers, of course, especially. And I found some as a Chinese buyer for tiger bone, and it was a very dangerous thing to do. Those places, if you're talking about wildlife protection, even policemen wouldn't dare to go into those enclaves. If you are a policeman in isolation, you get killed. You go in there three at a time, four at a time, and you call people, come back out safe. I went there as an undercover operator, and it was extremely dangerous, but I have to match wits with those guys, and I just barely survived. But I spent 3 weeks doing that, and then I had to go into the tiger reserves, and there was a Japanese guy who took over from me, and he was killed within the first week, taking over from me. And so the law doesn't reach those areas. So even though there may be tiger protection,